As usual, by the time of the day, we get jammed up. Let me see, I think maybe you'd like this back.
That's fine.
I want to miss you, President.
I don't miss you,
thank
too.
Thank you, President.
Well, thank you.
Great experience.
And good luck.
Well, thank you. Good luck to you.
All right. And just a little souvenir,
well,
so you won't forget us.
Thank you. I promise I'll never forget you. Thank you very much.
All
Anything
right.
I can do to help, just let me know.
Okay. So bless.
Take care.
Well, I went to the cross.
Yes. Okay.
Good. That's a promise.
Good. Thank you.
Yes.
James.
Well, listen, welcome everybody, and let's get going because we've got a few things to talk about. I first wanted to take a little bit here to report on our meetings that we've had. The Monday meeting with King Hussein was a good meeting, and I have to say, with all the setbacks and everything, he's shown a great deal of courage and is still in there and striving to see if we can before the year is out and get into outright face-to-face negotiations with Israel. And I think the recent episodes of violence just emphasize not that we should draw back, but the greater urgency needed to go forward. His courage and leadership haven't been without major risks, of course, in that area. He's under constant and unremitting pressure from all of those who are opposed to a peaceful settlement. And that's why to meet their legitimate defense needs, which have become much more evident because of his willingness to take this on board, is that I propose that we sell those defensive arms to him. And I hope that you'll recognize that he has put himself at risk, and there's every evidence that this is desperately needed. So I'd like to ask for your support so that we can continue to go on for direct negotiations and adjusting lasting peace. And that would ultimately be the greatest contribution to Israel to make them more secure as well as ourselves. But now last week we also had productive meetings with Soviet Foreign Minister Shevardnadze, in which we outlined our approaches on U.S.-Soviet issues, including human rights, regional issues, bilateral matters, and of course, security and arms control. Now, when I say we had productive meetings, we recognize that the meeting was only kind of discussing the agenda for the coming meeting in November. But I'm quite convinced that Mr. Shevardnadze has had to go back to Moscow with the news that we're for real with regard to disarmament. And it isn't any game that we're playing. And I think also that after our conversation, he's going back, if he reports honestly, which I'm sure he will, to his boss back there, that we need to, not only on that, but if they've got any hopes that we're going to waffle around as we've done in the past and settle for whatever looks cosmetically proper, no, because we made it very plain to him that the United States is not seeking superiority in military strength, but we're not going to let anyone else have sufficient military superiority to ever be able to threaten us, to be able to deliver an ultimatum on a surrender or die basis. We'll do whatever it takes to see that we're able to defend ourselves. I think we would want that in mind. We reaffirmed our strong interest, as I said, however, with regard to the defense and encouraging them to see defensive things for a mix of offense and defense that could lead to what both of us have expressed, and that is a desire to get rid of nuclear weapons entirely. He brought me a letter from Gorbachev, had a little trouble with it, written in Russian. So I found it out to be delivered back, and basically what it did was talk about the proposal that finally has been presented at Geneva. This is the first time that I can recall that they have ever come forth with an actual number and said that they were going to talk about a number of weapons that they would reduce. We've had such a proposal on the table ever since the negotiations started. And all they've done is sit there and make speeches and never come back as you would in normal negotiations and say, well, we can't buy your figure, but here's our figure, and then you start asking us to how close you can get to each other. That's never taken place. I assume that it will now that there's two sets of numbers on the table. It's clear that Western unity and firmness brought them to the negotiating table after they'd walked out in 1983 for over a year, and after a lot of posturing about moratoriums and freezes and so forth, they are, as I say, proposing reductions. I don't want to get into the details of the Soviet proposal and our initial assessment that belongs at the table between the negotiators, not out in public. But for one thing, the Soviets are still laying it out there. Not everything you read about it in the papers is quite accurate. So now I'm going to ask Bud if he'll a few words to say also about the situation in these meetings.
President.